have to go back to Dr. Nicholson's work, and you have to go back to other work, and you find out that there is a microorganism which causes a great deal of damage to the human body that is known to the leading scientists of North America, but is not passed on to the general practitioners who are treating people who are ill. And that microorganism is called the mycoplasma. And the mycoplasma is simply a particle of bacterial DNA. And when the bacteria is killed, that particle of the DNA tries to find a cell in the human body or in other animals or even in plants and trees. The research demonstrates that trees, for example, can suffer from chronic fatigue syndrome, and just as well as human beings do. Well, we had Dr. Nicholson, this leading scientist who has pioneered this great and important study, and who demonstrates that many of these diseases, again, I mentioned the key ones, for example, Parkinson's and AIDS, are caused when the cell membrane is destroyed and the cell dumps its contents into the blood or the plasma. And then we tracked it to, well, what causes the cell membrane to deteriorate and rupture? And we learned there's a mycoplasma. And then we learned, as I say, that the U.S. government, a number of years ago, began to research the mycoplasma very, very rigorously. And they got to the point where they patented. Now, don't ask me how they can get this through a patent office, but the U.S. government was able to patent what they call the pathogenic, that is disease-causing, the pathogenic mycoplasma. And in that patent, which is about 85 pages long and a marvelous document to read, it says, now this is in a patent held by the United States government, and the main work was done by their leading medical doctor researcher, Dr. Shai-Ching Lo, president and director of the American Institute of Pathology. And in that patent, he says, people who are infected with the mycoplasma will be patients who have been diagnosed by their physician as having, and he lists, AIDS, chronic fatigue syndrome, Wegener's disease, Kabuchi's disease, lupus, and on down the line, and he ends up by saying, and even Alzheimer's. Well, if you have a disease agent patented by the United States government, which is involved in all of these diseases, how in the heck is it you haven't heard of it? And most of your listeners will not have heard of it. And even your listeners who are medical practitioners will not have heard of it. Or if they have heard of it, it has been dismissed to them. Now, in one of these journals, and you kind of catch me by surprise by having the number of copies here, so I'm not sure which journal it is. Here it is here. In one of these journals, we have a picture of a medical textbook which is published for the general population of the United States by the Johns Hopkins Medical School. Now you think Johns Hopkins Medical School, that is a prestigious world leader in medical research and all the rest of it, and this book, we've published a cover there to illustrate it. It has over 1,800 pages, and it is supposed to be America's number one medical authority. They say so themselves. Nothing modest about them. Johns Hopkins Family Health Book. And if you go through those 1,800 pages by way of the index, nowhere in that book, which is America's number one health authority, do you even find a mention of the word mycoplasma and of the microbiological or microorganism, the mycoplasma? And yet, if you turn to another copy of a journal, you will find the page from the patent reproduced where it says the mycoplasma is involved in AIDS, common chronic fatigue syndrome, Wegener's, sarcoidosis, lupus, and even Alzheimer's. How is it that America's leading researchers and medical people and America's leading medical school say absolutely nothing to the public or to the medical practitioners about the mycoplasma, and yet in their own documentation they indicate what a tragic disease agent it is? And if you're going to treat some of the diseases involved, you have to start by treating the mycoplasma. But if you don't know the mycoplasma even exists, you're not going to treat it. And if you try to refer, for example, to the John Hopkins medical book, you won't find anything in there about it. So how are you going to respond to the mycoplasma if A, you don't know it exists, and B, you don't know how to respond, and C, your medical practitioner doesn't know it exists, and so on. And to carry this illustration along a little further, I'm a retired teacher, and I'm a member of the Retired Teachers of Ontario. And in the last newsletter, they had a blurb in there, "Great news, the John Hopkins Medical School has put all of this important health information on the web, and if you put in johnhopkins.com, whatever it is, you can then put in any word that you want to know about in terms of its medical significance." So I'm not involved with computers myself because I got enough to do just doing other things. But I asked my son, I said, "Okay, put in johnhopkinsmedical.com, blah, 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 and these sort of stuff," and he did. And I said, "Now put down mycoplasma and see what comes out."
He did a search for the word.
Search for mycoplasma. And it says, "Sorry, no information on this subject available." Excuse me. So then I had him go to the parent of the mycoplasma, which is a bacterium called the Brucella bacterium, or brucellosis bacterium. And again, it comes up, "Sorry, there's no information on this in our data bank." John Hopkins University has a program that you can access and is supposed to give you all the latest information, yet the most critical information, the information that deals with diabetes type 1, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and all the rest of it, is not available to you through that program and that database. And through their textbook here, which you can go down and you buy at a bookstore for $50, $60, not a word in it about this disease agent.